This video is brought to you by CatBeast.com. Design your own custom snapbacks and hats.
Hey guys, this is EckhartsLadder. Hello and welcome to another Star Wars Top 5 list. And today we have what I think is another really fun episode. And it's one that you guys wanted because I put this up to the Discord and you guys voted for this one pretty heavily. I don't really have any announcements for today's video, but I will say the Discord is reaching 1,000 users. It might be already there by the time this video is released, so if you want to join, engage in some lovely Star Wars discussion, and vote on future video ideas, feel free to join. I'll put a link down below. Also, feel free to follow me on Twitter, and if you want to support the channel, you can do so on Patreon. Speaking of selling myself out, thank you very much to the sponsor for today's episode. Without them and the support of you guys, it would be very difficult for me to do this channel full time. So on to the video. Today we're looking at the top 5 most deadly, most powerful, most badass ground vehicles used during the Clone Wars, anything by either the Separatists or the Republic. I'm not going to distinguish here. I'm also using a very liberal definition of ground vehicle. So if something uses, for example, repulsor lift technology, I'm going to call that a ground vehicle. I mean, when you look at Luke Skywalker's ground speeder, although it technically does hover using repulsor lifts, you'd still consider it a ground vehicle. So I'm going to do the same here. Also, any sort of walker, any sort of large droid, any sort of unconventional ground-based weapon is totally fine for this episode. Just because I'm curious to see what you guys think, right now take a second and vote on whether you think the number one spot will be held by either the Republic or the Confederacy of Independent Systems, and at the end of the video when we get to number one, you can see whether you were right. Alright, so number five, and I'm not gonna lie, I went back and forth quite a few times on this one. On one hand, we have the All-Terrain Tactical Enforcer, also known as the ATTE, probably one of the most common and really most powerful units of the Republic. This walker was quite versatile, it was fairly powerful, and it was also quite large. However, also vying for number 5 in my heart was the Confederacy's Octuptarra Magna Tri Droid, often called the Tri Droid, or as I call it, the Giant Tri Droid. Both of these vehicles have something going for them. The Tactical Enforcer is taller and larger than the Tri Droid, and it's probably quite a bit more armored. However, what I like most about the Magna Tri Droid is its versatility, how it can be plopped down in battle and immediately do serious damage, and it's got a few interesting design features which really contribute to this versatility. And really, just its speed, its deadliness, and its battlefield awareness and tactical impact is what made me choose the Tri-Droid as the fifth position on this list. Probably the most notable feature of the Tri-Droid is that it can see in all directions and fire in all directions at once, due to the presence of sensors along what I'm calling its head, and also 3 turrets which fire out very powerful rockets. The Tri-Droid also operates at range, and is sort of like a mobile artillery unit, which is quite unique in battle. We see, briefly, during the Battle of Mygeetto, during Order 66, that one of these droids easily takes out a Republic UT-AT walker, which is quite a large vehicle itself. I think this will be a controversial pick. It's not only the smallest vehicle on this list, but is much smaller than many other potential vehicles that could have fit the number 5 spot. I said earlier that it's the speed that makes this vehicle great, but really, it's not the speed, but the mobility. I mean, compare its 3 nimble legs with, for example, the 6 bulky legs of the ATTE. This mobility, along with its deadliness and sort of a compact power, is why I've chosen the Tri-Droid as the number 5 spot on this list. Alright, so on to number 4, and at this spot we have the SPHA, the Self-Propelled Heavy Artillery Walker. This vehicle is basically the opposite of the Tri-Droid. It's not very mobile, but it is extraordinarily powerful. As the name would suggest, the SPHA was a very heavy artillery unit in service of the Republic. The SPHA was essentially a walking weapon, a weapon which was configurable depending on the mission type. Standard loadout for the vehicle included a giant turbo laser. We saw this featured for the first time during the Battle of Geonosis. Multiple turbo lasers were actually powerful enough to take down a Lucra Hulk core ship. And in fact, these weapons were so powerful that during the Battle of Geonosis, multiple SPHAs were installed within the hangars of Venator-class Star Destroyers and used to take down enemy ships. As I mentioned earlier, you could switch out the main weapon on this walker with either some sort of ion cannon or a mass driver or some other weapon type, but really, the purpose was the same. Long-range artillery for taking out heavy targets. We see during Geonosis that SPHAs can also operate as command platforms due to probably their distance from the front lines and their armor, but That's likely a secondary function. These aren't the most versatile vehicles. However, what they do very well, which is why the SPHA is the fourth greatest Clone Wars era ground vehicle. Number three, and representing the halfway point on this list, is the Confederate Super Tank. You really get to see this vehicle in action for the first time in the Weapons Factory episode of the Clone Wars. And when you see it for the first time, it's pretty unassuming. I mean, it looks like some sort of bug, it doesn't really look very impressive, but this vehicle has a lot to offer. The most impressive feature of the Super Tank is its insane durability. When the Republic encounters the Super Tank for the first time, they attack it with several artillery cannons from a distance. Now, artillery just generally is quite powerful, and the Republic, as well as myself when I first watched it, fully expected these vehicles to go down. However, the initial barrage isn't even enough to take down the shields of the vehicles, as recognized by the battle droids commanding them. What happens next is, at least in my mind, even more surprising. The tank opens up and a previously unseen compartment holding missiles is revealed. Two salvos of these missiles take out not only the artillery which just attacked them, but also advancing all-terrain tactical enforcers. Quite an impressive show of force. I think that these artillery-based weapons, however, also kind of highlight the weakness of these vehicles. That's the short game. While these vehicles are very well defended, someone like a Jedi with a lightsaber or perhaps some other cutting weapon can do serious damage up close, and besides for a couple of MTT-style laser cannons, the tank doesn't really have a whole lot else to defend up close. Still, like the previous entry on this list, the Super Tank excels in its specialized role, and its durability is beyond impressive. And really, the engineers who designed this were probably limited in the amount of weapons they could have put on by the actual design of the tank, which is clearly very heavily armored. I would have liked to see other Super Tank variants, like perhaps a troop transporter version, and I guess we might have had the war gone on, but for now, this version of the Super Tank is the third best Clone Wars era vehicle. At number 2, we have probably one of my favorite designs that came out of the Clone Wars, the HAVw A6 Juggernaut, also known just generally as the Juggernaut. And for good reason, when you see this thing for the first time, you don't quite realize how much of a beast it is. But when you look at it next to some clones, the 30 meter height and almost 50 meter length really hit you, and you just realize how massive this thing is. This impressive size gives the tank some tactical advantages. I mean, it's basically a battleship on wheels. It can carry a few hundred troops, is very heavily armored, and also packs pretty decent weaponry. One notable thing about the Juggernaut, and the thing that really separates it from the walkers of the era, was its speed. The fact that the Juggernaut uses wheels actually allows it to have a very large frame, which has the benefits that I just mentioned, while also being able to achieve a top speed of over 150 kilometers an hour. Really, this thing can do it all. Attack enemies with its heavy weapons, including missile launchers and grenade launchers, act as a sort of mobile operations base, or transport troops into battle. There are some build issues with the vehicle, and it's probably not the best thing for long-term use, but in any given battle, I would take the Juggernaut over almost any other ground vehicle during the Clone Wars. Number 1 is a vehicle that only appears one time within the Star Wars universe. That is the Seismic Tank, and if you guys haven't seen this one before, I wouldn't be surprised. It appeared only in the early 2000s Clone Wars series, but man, is its appearance ever cool. Although at first glance, the Seismic Tank seems to be some sort of flying vehicle, it's actually a repulsor lift vehicle, not unlike a speeder or a conventional military tank. It just uses its repulsor lifts to stay relatively high up in the air. From this vantage point, the gargantuan vehicle would essentially use its seismic driver to hammer the battlefield. This unique weapon would not only pulverize any units unlucky enough to be caught in range, but would also create a shockwave, decimating any nearby forces. Now, of course, this vehicle has an almost unending list of drawbacks. One, it's very, very slow. Two, you cannot distinguish between enemy and friend when using the weapon. And three, the combination of these two things means that you can't sneak up on the enemy, so you can only really use the weapon in the middle of battle. This means that you'll likely be incurring heavy losses every time you use the weapon. However, for the Separatists, fighting a war of attrition with an almost unending amount of battle droids, this made a lot of sense. The vehicle would have also probably been vulnerable to long-range artillery, but given its sheer size and its original purpose as a mining vehicle, it's most likely quite durable. To see these awesome machines in action, Watch chapters 12 and 13 of The Clone Wars, where you see the Battle of Dantooine showing not only these things, but also the full power of Mace Windu, which is definitely worth seeing. Anyways guys, those were my top 5 Clone Wars era ground vehicles. Down in the comments, let me know what you thought of this episode, let me know if my list was on point, or if I forgot something important. Also, if you made it this far into the video, let me know down in the comments what your favorite ground-based vehicle used by both factions is. Anyways, thank you so much for watching, guys. As always, this has been EckhartsLadder. May the Force be with you.